G'day, Chris here, and welcome back to Clickspring.
As I continue with the construction of the Lunar Phase Assembly, in this video I go a little deeper on the detail of some of the parts, to provide a clearer picture of life at the bench for the maker of this ancient mechanism. Without the opportunity to sit alongside the maker throughout the process, it's often not obvious from a finished piece just how much time has been invested into making it. Using files, forging and drilling, the components of the Antikythera mechanism were essentially hand-carved and sculpted from raw metal stock. Sometimes the rate of material removal or formation would have been satisfyingly fast, with a part taking shape quickly. But more often, it was excruciatingly slow and tedious work, as one part was carefully worked into shape relative to another, to give a required standard of fit or mechanical relationship. In this type of work, time is a secondary consideration. In the mind of the worker, all that matters is getting the fit, the clearance, the exact mechanical outcome, because without that, it's all for nothing. The components that I'm making in this video capture that fact perfectly. And although a video emphasizing the tedium of process is probably not the best formula for viewer success, I very much want you to experience this aspect of the mechanism's construction. In fact, if there's one thing that I'd like you to take away from this video, it's that in addition to the tool technology, the materials, and the knowledge mentioned in previous videos, constructing the Antikythera mechanism in antiquity was mostly about this. A whole lot of slow and patient working of the metal with hand tools to get things to be just so. Now, given what we know of the high costs of the raw material, the maker was obliged to think carefully about how best to make use of raw stock. To some extent, forging the basic outline of a part provides for efficient material use. But that must be balanced against the risk of pushing things too far, and possibly losing the part due to errors inherent to the process. For example, this drilled component could have been pre-forged a little closer to the final part perimeter before drilling. But the hole must be perfectly aligned with the component's flanks once complete, and there's a possibility of it wandering slightly during the drilling process. The solution is to balance this risk against the need to conserve material with a compromise, leaving on just enough raw stock to be certain of being able to correct for errors with files when required, but not leaving on so much that it leads to unnecessary waste of valuable material. For other components, the pre-forging process can be pushed much closer to the final form. Again, still with the consideration of making sure that there's enough material left on to ensure that all features can be formed where they need to be. In terms of explaining manufacturing processes from the era of the mechanism's construction up to our modern world, the process that you're watching unfold right now of two parts being slowly fitted together by hand according to the needs of a specific feature, in this case this slot, is probably the most important that I've covered throughout the series. This handwork is the foundation of the pre-industrial method of engineering, and it remained essentially unchanged for thousands of years until modern industrialization. Despite whatever changes in tool technology they may notice, a jeweler, watch or clockmaker from the 18th or 19th century would immediately recognize what's going on here, because it was their daily experience too. Much like I've mentioned previously about working with other hand tools like the bow lathe, this is yet another deeply human interaction of hand, eye, tool and workpiece, with absolute measurement rarely a consideration. Each dimension is almost always determined relative to another, and the characteristics of how those components should fit together, how they should feel and sound when interacting, exists as a clear physical sensation in the mind of the maker. Now, as these parts have progressed, you'll notice that I've chosen a fairly specific order of operations to form them. As it happens, there's an opportunity to use the parts with each other in their half-formed state to achieve a certain alignment essential for the mechanism's correct operation. This is an example of the many considerations that would have passed through the mind of the maker on the way to completing various sections of the mechanism. The use of a natural feature to achieve an otherwise difficult result. The preference of a particular method over another to perhaps sidestep a potential hazard. And above all, the careful sequencing of operations. All of these small, day-to-day, highly consequential choices are familiar to us today from our own making experiences. In this case, I've chosen a sequence to provide a reliable setup for fastening and then separating a component in place to replicate the excellent alignment that we can see in the CT scans. The scans also show a thin, radio-dense layer where the receiving components join the circular plate, suggesting a layer of tin-lead solder. I've covered the process of soldering in antiquity in a previous Fragments video, so be sure to check that one out for more detail. On this occasion, much the same requirements apply. The work must fit well together, have a suitable gap within which the solder can flow, and perhaps most importantly of all, the surfaces to be bonded must be free from oxides. The solder has flowed in much the same way as we can see in the scans, through to each edge of the part. But interestingly, I ended up with some small spots of solder, flung off while dragging it with the pick, that resembles something that's been pointed out in the research as also possibly being solder spatter. The small radio-dense items in the scans may yet prove to be something else. But it is interesting to see just how easily something similar can be deposited as a natural part of the process. In any event, the work must now be cleaned up for the next fitting operations. The recently soldered part can now be separated along this axis, ensuring alignment of the two halves. This pipe component can now be manually fitted to the plate, with the intention being that it have a well-aligned and close fit. As part of the fitting process, the various other required features are also formed. The final fit is achieved with repeated test fits and light adjusting cuts where required. And with that, these components are finished for the moment, with perhaps some light filing required at a later stage as other parts are made and further clearances determined. In a standard working shop, where filming isn't the priority, this would have taken maybe a couple of days for an experienced worker to complete. Almost all of that time would have been spent at a simple bench much like this, using much the same collection of tools. Carefully working the parts into what they need to be, guarding against mistakes, and preparing the work and the mind for what comes next. Thanks for watching. I'll see you later.